Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Hard to believe, but Jesus does have a number of things in common with us. And one of those is he has a dad too. His father sent him into the world to bring him the gift that he most wanted. It wasn't a tie, though. No, it's you and me. And that's just what Jesus did. Jesus taught, he healed, and he did miracles so that he could present you and me as a gift to his Father, just as his Father most desired. Jesus says to us today in our gospel, "So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven." These are Jesus' words to his disciples, not just the 12 who are gathered together on that hillside in Galilee, but to all of his disciples, including you and me. Hear his words again to you. Jesus said, "So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven." It's Jesus' mission, his desire to please his Father in heaven, that all mankind should publicly profess their faith in him so that he can in turn publicly profess his allegiance to us before his Father in heaven, presenting us to him as his children. However, before these words of comfort and promise from Jesus to us, Jesus also has some distressing things to say as he gets his disciples ready for the work that he has in store for them. These words will no doubt cause doubt, consternation, and real fear among those disciples and among us here today. But fortunately, unlike those disciples, you and I have the advantage of seeing first how the story actually unfolds in its entirety. I've told you before that I'm one of those guys who, when he gets a tight, suspenseful novel to read, he likes to read the end first, because knowing the end can help me as I'm on the journey, on the edge of my seat, amid all the tension that goes in the hard parts, all the plot twists and all the plot turns. So how does God's story end? Well, we don't have to wonder. God tells us in his word. In the book of Revelation, he says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, 'Behold, I am making all things new. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my child.'" And this is the end of the story. This is how it ends, my brothers and sisters. All who believe in Jesus, regardless of what happens to them in this life, no matter how scary their life might be, they are part of this new creation. All who boldly confess the name of Jesus need not fear. Today, these believers in Christ are God's children while here on earth. One day, these same believers will live with their Father in heaven. Gifts from the Son to him, just as the Father desires. So, don't let fear stop you from doing the Father's work. Jesus doesn't mince words with us in our gospel today. He knows that being a disciple of his is not going to be easy. He knows the work that he calls us to do will be fraught with danger, physical, emotional, and spiritual danger. There will be rejection from the people we love. There will be persecution of all kinds. There might even be physical pain, suffering, and even death. These are scary things, no doubt. But Jesus urges us, don't let fear stop you. There's a lot of unknowns for us going forward. But we know how the story ends for each of us. Don't let fear stop you. While we may even have to give up our lives here on earth, Jesus promises to intercede before his Father in heaven on our behalf. Don't let fear stop you. And while it may seem that we have been forgotten as we suffer insults, rejection, and worse, Jesus reminds us how much our Father in heaven truly cares for each of us. He has numbered each of the 100 or 1,000 or so hairs that we are born with. He even knows which of those hairs have escaped down the drain during the course of our lives. And one day, he might even restore each and every one, one by one. So don't let fear stop you. Jesus encourages us to trust his Father's love, his grace, and his mercy to help us push through our fear as we publicly confess Jesus, who is and what he came to do. He encourages us to boldly confess him as the true and only Son of God, as the long-awaited Messiah of Israel, as a light to the Gentiles, and as the ransom for all of the world's sinners, including you and me, who are held captive by Satan. And within the confines of our Christian bubbles, we do boldly confess Jesus, along with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We just did it in the Nicene Creed. And we do it via the Apostles and the Athanasian Creeds. But you know, as we go out into the world, it can become difficult to face the hostility toward God and his word. And so Jesus also warns us in his word today, whoever denies me before men, I also will deny before my Father who is in heaven. The public denial of Jesus, who he is and what he's done, is a denial of God. Whether we do this overtly through actual words of denial or covertly, through our silence in the face of potential public ridicule, persecution, and suffering. The first commandment says, you shall have no other gods. And in the small catechism, this is explained as, we should fear, love, and trust God above all things. Denying Jesus shows a lack of trust in God and his promises. Denying Jesus shows that we fear man more than we fear God. And without repentance, this denial can lead to destruction of faith. The public denial of God began with Adam and Eve. They put themselves ahead of God, deciding to trade in their Creator for a God they felt more comfortable with, themselves. Averting their heavenly gaze, they turned inward, staring at themselves. What is it that I want? What is it that I need? And this turning inward on ourselves continues today. When asked to confess Jesus, we must confess all of him, not just the parts we find to our liking. When we see violence in the public square, whether it's committed on babies or the elderly or on people we don't like, Jesus says, "Don't let your fear stop you. Confess me with your words and deeds." When we see sexual immorality and evil desires in the public square, whether it's acted out in the workplace or on TV or under the selfish guise of love and just feeling good, Jesus says, "Don't let your fear stop you. Confess me with your words and deeds." When we see lying and half-truths spoken to gain unrighteous advantage over others, whether it's blatant falsification, uninformed rumor-mongering, or simply water-cooler gossip, Jesus says, "Don't let your fear stop you. Confess me with your words and your deeds." It is unpopular to confess Jesus, but he will more than make up for it as he confesses you before his heavenly Father. Our Father in heaven understands the difficulties we face. He understands that we are surrounded by enemies in the public square. He knows how our fear can drive us away from him. And in fact, one might say that that is our Father's fear, that Satan will drive us away from him. Our Father doesn't want our death to be the end of our story. He wants to change our ending. Jesus makes the point in our gospel today, saying, "Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not. Therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows." How much does our Father in heaven value us? He values us so much so that he sent his only son, Jesus, to suffer and die for us, that each of us might, through his death, receive the gift of eternal life. Jesus understands our fears. As he fulfilled his Father's mission, he fell to his knees. In agony, he prayed, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." And he prayed as his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. Jesus was betrayed by one of his own disciples. His disciples denied him. They scattered in fear for the hills, for their own safety. Even Peter, first among the disciples, overcame with fear for his own life, publicly denied Jesus, not once, but three times. Left alone, Jesus was forced to carry his own cross. He carried it to the top of Mount Calvary. He was stripped naked. He was nailed to his cross. And he suffered, and he died, and he was buried. And then he descended into hell to declare his victory over Satan and his weapon of fear. 3 days later, Jesus secured his victory. He rose from the dead to new life. He overcame the power of death in the grave so that we no more have to fear anything, even death. When Jesus appeared to his fearful disciples, their denial was turned into acknowledgement. He forgave every one of them, including Peter. He gave them his peace, and he commanded them to proclaim his name from the highest housetops for all to hear. And even Peter, that disciple who once feared to confess Jesus to a few people around a little bitty campfire, this Peter publicly confessed Jesus in the face of thousands in the city streets of Jerusalem, saying with the utmost boldness, "Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you. God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins." Peter boldly confessed the name of Jesus until the day that he too was crucified. You and I, like Peter, fall into fear. At times, we fail to confess Jesus' name. Yet also, like Peter, the Holy Spirit dwells within us. We can't possibly believe in Jesus, let alone confess all that he has done for us, for all to hear, by our own strength. However, this same Holy Spirit, the one who enabled the 12 to push through their fear as they boldly confessed Jesus to the world, this same Holy Spirit causes us to confess. First, we confess our sins, that we may receive our Father's forgiveness for all the times when we fail to confess the name of Jesus. And then, our faith in Jesus, we boldly confess that faith out in the world through our words and through our deeds. By the power of the Holy Spirit, the reality of our faith in Christ is fearlessly expressed for all to hear. Our Father in heaven calls each of us his children. We are redeemed by him through the Holy Spirit. We speak his word anywhere he places us. And we embrace through his love anyone who comes into our presence. Each week, we come in to God's presence to joyfully proclaim God's word, to accept his gifts of mercy and grace for our sins, to thank and praise him for all that he has given to us, and to receive his blessing for the work he has called us to do in the coming week. And as we go out into the world, we continue to remain in his presence through our prayers, by studying his word. And we ask the Holy Spirit to help us discern our Father's will as we publicly confess the name of Jesus through our lives of sacrificial love for others in our community. In these and many other ways, we live out our mission as we enthusiastically share the love of Jesus, as we confess his name for all to see and hear. Despite suffering now in this place, you and I, we can rest assured in God's promise found at the end of his story. One day, Jesus will stand with each one of us before his Father, saying to his Father, "Father, here is your child, the one you love, the one who acknowledged me. Here is my gift to you." And we shall live with him forever. We might even have full heads of hair. Have no fear, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Have no fear. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen.